Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Atheist Experience. We are live Sunday, January 13th, 2008. The last show, if you were just watching, I don't know, public access, was not live. This one's live, unless you're watching the rebroadcast of this or watching via Google Video, and then it's not live, but we'll sort it out. Today's Sunday, January 13th, 2008. We're on the air from 3 to 4:30 p.m. Central. This, as I said, is a live public access television program sponsored by the Atheist Community of Austin, a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. The ACA has weekly meetings every Sunday, beginning at 11:30 at Romeo's on Barton Springs Road, except for the first Sunday of the month when we host a lecture series at the Austin History Center, located at the corner of 9th and Guadalupe. Today was the regular Sunday meeting. It was supposed to be a board meeting as well, but I sent out a notice late canceling it because we had a lot of other events going on this weekend, including a wedding. So, in addition to this program, the ACA also sponsors a biweekly internet audio podcast called The Nonprofits. That's P-R-O-P-H-E-T-S. You can, for more information about The Nonprofits, you can go to nonprofitsradio.com. We will be live this coming Saturday. We're live every other Saturday from 2 to 3:30. Ish Central. You can get more information about how to connect to the program and participate in the IRC chat service that we provide along with it. I don't know for sure for the people who've been curious, because Dennis is hosting it, I'm co-hosting, Shilling's been joining us, but Jeff and Russell have kind of halfway pledged to attend more often in the 2008 season.
Ah, okay.
Which I'll have to find out for sure if either of them will be down there this coming Saturday, but stay tuned for that. We'll have more information about that later in the week at the website. The audio portion of this program is available as a podcast, much the same way as the nonprofits is. And the video portion is available for download and viewing at googlevideo.com. For more information, you can go to atheist-experience.com. Click on the archive. There are a number of links there in the archive to past shows. I think we've got almost every show that we have video for has been uploaded now. So you'll get to see some of the past hosts. One of them is joining me today, Ashley Perrien.
Yes, thank you.
And Russell's on there, Jeff. I think there's some programs back from Martin, and I don't know. And we talked a little bit about during the 10th anniversary show. So there's lots of old stuff on there and some new stuff, and we're now viewable worldwide.
Yes, and I'm still on the email list, the TV at atheist-community.org. And it's interesting to see all the letters that come in. I think we just got one from Greece a couple days ago. Australia, Europe, Canada.
Yeah, it's great.
Pretty much every continent.
Yeah, I actually responded to the Greece one because during my time in the Navy, I spent some time in Greece, and I absolutely loved it. So if I ever decide to leave the United States, Greece is on the short list of places that I'd like to go. How can you not like hanging out in the Med?
Yeah. Now we just need some from Antarctica to complete the list. And if anybody in Antarctica happens to be watching, you're all scientists. We know that you know, at least somewhat agree. Go ahead and write us. We could use that.
Awesome.
We could use that expansion of the list here.
I don't have a full map of every continent that's actually written in so far, but it'd be cool to work it out. I did put a map up for that purpose, but haven't gotten around to it.
Yeah.
If you have any questions, comments, feedback, concerns, you can email tv@atheist-community.org. That goes to myself, the co-host, some of the people behind the scenes. You can also visit the ACA's website, www.atheist-community.org, for more information about everything that the ACA is doing and involved in. In addition to this program, the nonprofits program, and the lecture series, the ACA also hosts a number of social events throughout the week, including Atheist Happy Hour every Thursday at the Dog and Duck Pub, located at the corner of 17th and Guadalupe. That begins around 7 o'clock and continues until everybody disperses. Sometimes I think it's been really late on a few occasions.
Okay.
But we spent a great deal of time at the Dog and Duck this past week, because we had Thursday happy hour, then we had kind of a bachelor party there Friday. So it was a lot of fun. After this program's over, everybody involved in the show gets together and goes to dinner, and we're currently going to El Arroyo on 5th Street. The address is up on your screen. We're on until 4:30. We'll probably be at El Arroyo around 5 p.m., and that'll continue. I guess, you know, normally we used to try to shoot for the 5 to 7 p.m. time slot, but I think people will hang around longer or shorter depending on what kind of participation we get.
Yeah.
As always, all of our events are open to the public. Any atheist or atheist-friendly person is welcome to join us for almost anything we do. But if you're coming down to preach, proselytize, or provoke, please don't. We'll have a telephone number up for you shortly. You can call in and explain to us not only what you believe and why, but why you think somebody else should share your beliefs as well. If your view is that your beliefs are entirely personal and they're not justifiable to anybody else, I guess that's fine for you. I prefer to deal with reality that's, you know, kind of based on a shared understanding.
Yeah.
You know, where something is real and defined as real by the fact that other people can confirm it as well. So for ACA members, as always, a quick note that if you'd like to submit contributions to the newsletter, please do so. You can email editor@atheist-community.org, and that'll go to myself, Don, and Tracy. And I don't know that I have... Oh, well, I do have actually kind of two specialish announcements.
Okay.
That aren't really related to the ACA, and I don't have all of the required information. The Texas Citizens for Science are putting on kind of a symposium Wednesday.
Okay.
You can go to texscience.org. It's TexScience.org, and there's more information up there if you're in the Austin area. They're going to be talking about the recent attacks on science education in Texas, and where this is coming from, and is there a reason to be concerned, and what we can expect, both with regard to the recent firing of Chris Comer, who will be there, and also the Institute for Creation Research in Dallas has either recently been approved or is probably going to be approved to grant master's degrees in creation studies.
Oh, it was a master? I heard it. They were calling it a degree.
No, it's a master's degree. It's a post.
Okay.
It's a secondary education or post-secondary education, and they've changed the name, and it's going to be Creation Studies.
Okay.
And they're going to also be teaching evolution in this as well.
Yeah, but I heard that in this school you can only get accepted to the school if you, like, you have to sign this agreement that Jesus is your Lord and Savior. The Earth was created 6,000 years ago in six literal 24-hour days.
And gays will burn forever.
Exactly, and yes, you know, well, it's some behaviors that are banned.
Yeah.
Any homosexual behavior is banned and things like that. I can't remember. But yeah, it's kind of like you have to sign the statement saying, I think everything about evolution is wrong, but I'm going to have to learn it anyway.
Yeah. To me, I'm going to be planning on attending this event on Wednesday. There's more information at their website. I think it's around 7 o'clock at Amangia. But
okay.
To me, what the Institute for Creation Research is doing is not that different from what Answers in Genesis or Discovery Institute are doing. Basically, they can't get any peer-reviewed papers done. So what do? They go out and create their own peer-reviewed journals.
Yeah.
Well, the thing about peer review is you can call it peer review, but it's not by just slapping the peer review label on there and having it reviewed by your peers doesn't mean that anybody's going to take it seriously.
Yeah.
The thing about peer-reviewed papers is that they're distributed among the experts in the fields. The review is only as good as the peers you choose. So if a bunch of young Earth creationists get
together, course they're going to present it as in, we did give this to all the experts who actually know about creation science and are you know, well-versed in it.
Yes.
And so we have distributed it to all of those knowledgeable people, and they all agree with us 100%.
Yeah, and I'm sure that the National Association of Psychics and Astrologers will come out with their peer-reviewed journal where other psychic and astrologer nut jobs will confirm, I agree with her forecast for your future. But the other kind of
peer-reviewed forecast and predictions for the next year.
You'd think, I mean, even though it wouldn't do anything to demonstrate that astrology is anything more than nonsense, what it may do is help create kind of a more unified method of predicting. Because basically these guys just go out and make stuff up.
Yeah.
And the more vague in general it can be, the better off they are, because then it looks like
the less likely you can refute it.
But you could pick up two newspapers from the same town if you carry a couple, and they both, I don't know why newspapers still carry an astrology section.
I know. Your horoscope and everything. Yeah.
And they'll be completely different, but they'll both fit. How is that?
Yeah.
I mean, you just have to think about it for just a minute or so, and I think you'll realize that, yes, it could apply to anybody.
And I was like, I mean, I still see those experiments every once a year, so I see them that come up on different shows where they go into a college class, something like that, and they give everyone their personalized astrological reading. And it's like a 3 or 4 page document.
I can't believe
of their personality and their family and their history and everything about them. And they read it, and half of them are like in tears, saying they know me so well.
Yeah.
And then they get up and they trade them all around, find out everybody's got the same one.
Definitely.
So.
And the other, the other special announcement is just kind of something that I was personally interested in and maybe attending tonight. I noticed an article in the Statesman about a former creationist who's now an evangelist for evolution. And specifically, wow. He has accepted evolution and has found a way of reconciling evolution and his belief in a God, in particular, the Jesus God thing.
Okay.
But he's going to be speaking tonight, I think at 7 o'clock, at the Unitarian Universalist Church on Grover.
Okay.
So I'm probably going to go down and attend that because I'm always curious. I mean, I didn't become an atheist just because of evolution. Evolution and atheism aren't in any way tied together. And I understand, and I've met quite a few believers who also accept evolution as well. And I've never really had anybody give me a good explanation of how these two mesh, how there's not a contradiction. And the best I've ever heard is, well, basically you chuck out all that religious stuff. It has to do with origins, and you accept evolution, and then you stick God in everywhere where evolution doesn't, explain something. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So really what you're saying is in the areas that we don't have a good answer, you're just going to plug God in.
Yeah.
Okay, I got it.
Well, it's one of these things that many people don't really look at in depth, and I hadn't looked at it either for a long, 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 long time. Most people would treat it as two completely separate things. I believe in Jesus and God, and he rescued our souls and everything else. And then I also believe that, we come from previous ancestors and evolution and everything. That's where we got. And they just don't think, okay, these are actually in the same timeline. They have to occur at the same time. And if we did evolve from previous, versions and earlier ancestors, then we don't need to be saved. There's nothing wrong with it.
You can't have original sin.
Exactly. There's no original sin or anything like that. So there can be no need to have Jesus or anything like that. So it, at least how it's portrayed in the Bible. So they don't mesh. So
yeah, and I even have one kind of evo-theologist try and claim that the fact that sciences refer to mitochondrial Eve.
Yes.
Supports their idea of Adam and Eve. No. This was the dumbest labeling move ever, I guess, in the history of science. They try to be nice, and they try to create this metaphor.
Yeah.
That they hope will help explain things to people who don't have much understanding of evolution. So they call her mitochondrial Eve. This was no one woman who was the first woman. That dog gone hot. So
yes.
You got
yes, I've got
news bits,
a small handful of stories here. If we want to go ahead and put the number up, we definitely can do that.
Sure.
And also, as we were saying just a few minutes ago about, again, evolution and Jesus and stuff like that, if anyone out there can link these two together and say why we would need Jesus, even though there was no original sin, or is that a bad
Or maybe
statement, was there original sin, but we still evolved, or who knows? One of the monkeys did something off limits.
Well, evolution occurred, but God came down and tinkered with monkeys at some point and turned them into humans, and then they sinned, and then that was, okay, whatever.
Yeah.
Kind
of contrived.
Yeah, the more you have to kind of revisit and rationalize your story every time we come up with some new understanding about reality.
Yeah.
The less reasonable your story sounds.
Yeah.
You can tap dance all you want, but, these are issues that I actually find interesting. So, as a reminder, if you can see the number, we're probably live because you normally would put like pre-recorded right here over the number. But it is Sunday, January 13th, 2008.
Yes.
And you're free to call in to talk about the topic we were just discussing,
anything at
any
all,
any questions, news articles, or anything you'd like. Particularly, as I pointed out in several weeks in the past, I'm interested not only in what you believe and why, but why you think anybody else should believe it as well.
Yeah.
Or if you don't, maybe you're one of the people who thinks that all of this is private and not up for discussion, shouldn't be. Well,
in which case, we need to discuss that.
Yes, we need to discuss that with you.
All right.
So we can call you a hypocrite. Aha, gotcha.
All right, a couple of things here. First off, The View. That's this, I think it's daily, kind of chat show, talk show that's on. And it's got Whoopi Goldberg and a couple other people, and they just discuss various news and things that are going on and chat amongst themselves type thing, and they film it and broadcast it. They've had a couple things come out of that show in the past that was just a little bit wacky. A couple months back, one of the women basically said that she believes in creation, stuff like that, and she doesn't know if the world is flat or if it's round. It's something that she had never really looked into and studied, and therefore she doesn't know. And if her son asked that of her, she would have to, let's say, well, let's go to the library and look things up. The kind of point being that, you know, look, I have kids. Those are more important to me than the latest scientific research and science and things like that. And so that's why she may not be versed in these things.
Although, in fairness, if you think the issue of whether or not the Earth is flat around
is modern scientific discoveries.
I don't know how you got past second grade.
Yeah. But here's one that's actually on the opposite end of the spectrum. And what's interesting isn't so much the comment, but what's come up because of it. They've had a couple articles written about this. Joy, I think her name is Behar, was on that, and basically...
It's Bear.
Bear? Okay.
But, you know, last week I said that it was David Icke.
Yeah,
and which... I said Icke
which I've seen you've
joke.
Been inundated with.
I said Icke as a joke, but I would have pronounced it wrong anyway because I would have pronounced it as Ick, and it's actually David Icke.
Okay.
So I would have got it wrong anyway, but I did the Icke as a joke. But thank you for those people who corrected. And specifically, some people sent some links to some good videos, and there's one in particular somebody sent, and sorry to jump all over your news story, that was kind of a documentary about, very briefly touched on, he used to be a footballer and then a sports announcer and then a nutter. but it followed him through this tour in Canada where there was a group that was essentially trying to shut him down at every turn. And while I have no problem at all accepting that this guy is a complete loon, those people looked insanely foolish and actually did nothing but help his cause.
Really?
I mean, it was... let's dress up in an alien, a reptilian outfit and go to his book signing and hit him with a pie.
Yeah.
Let's threaten the radio stations, you know, if they put him on to have any kind of discussions at all. Now, in fairness, you know, I'm not up on Canadian laws, so I'll probably skew this a little with American laws on free speech, but... the radio station is completely within their rights to say, you know, no, we don't want you to have you on here. I mean, they're a business, and if they don't think that what he has to say is going to be good for their business, then they should shoot him down. He doesn't have an intrinsic right to appear on their radio station. But they did invite him, and it was only when he showed up there that they said, you know, now we've reviewed the material, and we don't think we should have you on. Well, you're within your rights, but you should have reviewed the material before you invited him on.
Yeah.
What you did was you've got this nut job who shows up and with a film crew, and now you look really stupid. You look like you are trying to suppress his conspiracy theory. And it just played horribly. They had like this city council of folks sitting around a table who were, you know, we want to make sure make this clear. We're all here in opposition to David Icke, and we don't want him, you know, spreading his message in our town because we consider it anti-Semitic and you know, various other things. And of course, one gentleman's there who's like, "Well, I don't really know that much about David Icke. What, can you tell me what it is about the message that we're objected to and everything else?" And they're like, no, we're not here to discuss or debate what the man has to say. We've already made up our minds. And if you're not here to also prevent him from speaking, then you can just leave.
Wow.
That's
shockingly bad.
Yes. And you know, I like to encourage discussion. I like open-mindedness and consideration. I wouldn't want to go sit through one of his lectures either. There are things that he says that I think are worth attacking and pointing out, but I'm not, the censorship thing just kind of gets to me. But also this idea that he's anti-Semitic, I'm not convinced. When the Anti-Defamation League tends to, and oh boy, I like you guys, but you tend to overreact. When David Icke or somebody else starts talking about this reptilian global conspiracy and mentions that some of the wealthy Jews who have control of certain industries are in on it, that's not anti-Semitic. If he said that all Jews were the reptiles or all the reptiles were Jews, okay, now you've got a case. But when he's saying no, the people who control the world in these various areas, they're all reptilian. And some of them happen to be Jewish, he's not being anti-Semitic. Get over it. You guys look so bad in that documentary. Oh,
and the fact that you even have to come on and officially put some kind of refutation or saying, we think he's anti-Semitic because he's a complete nut job.
Yeah.
You should be able to just safely ignore that completely. And when somebody comes to you and says, my God, did you know that he's saying that Jews are, reptilian?
Yeah.
They should be able to just laugh at them. And close the case. So, yeah. But
and then they interviewed Alex Jones, and interestingly, it was kind of cool because they filmed him actually walking out of the studio into the hallway and then having a conversation out in the hallway. So it was kind of felt like homey. And then I remembered, oh wait, it's Alex, who pointed out that David Icke's actually doing him a disservice because he's got it all right about the global conspiracy. And then he goes and puts a turd in the punch bowl by saying that they're reptiles. That's his phrase, not mine. I'm just quoting Alex on that. So, yeah.
That's a good one.
I loved it.
I'll have to use that sometime.
Kudos to you, Alex. I laughed twice for your turd in the punch bowl line. And he's right. He's not right about this global conspiracy stuff, as far as I can tell. But, that destroys it. So,
yeah.
He thinks that either David Icke's either insane or has bought into the conspiracy and is actually working. So this is the way conspiracy theory stuff works. There is this global conspiracy, and I know who did it. And then somebody else comes along, and they know who did it too, but it's a different somebody.
Yeah.
So now they're both actually in on the conspiracy, trying to undermine each other.
Yeah, they're trying to prove that each other is in the conspiracy, and he's part of it. So.
Anyway, enough recapping of conspiracy from last week. What was this story with Joy Bear?
Basically, she's a comedian who was on the show on, it says Wednesday, and this was January 10th, so it might have been on the 9th, I assume. And she basically said, I have a theory that you can't find any saints anymore because of psychotropic medication. I think that in the old days, the saints were hearing voices, and they didn't have any Thorazine to calm them down, Bear said on ABC's National Chat Fest. Now that we have all this medication available to us, you can't find a saint anymore. And the spokesman for The View, now again, that's the comment that was said. She's a comedian on a daytime chat show.
Not very funny, which is why she's on daytime chat shows.
But still, I mean, that's pretty good.
It's amusing.
And typically with comedians, especially, aimed at an adult audience, which, I mean, this isn't exactly, not kid-friendly, but it's not exactly for the children specifically. They're typically going to offend somebody out there, just jokingly. And so that's kind of how I'd view this. But apparently, they've had calls into the show, and they've got this article write-up about it, and the spokesman for The View said Joy was just joking. She said very clearly it was just a theory. She has lots of really funny theories that she kind of gives on a daily basis. She's a Catholic and she loves to talk about the Catholic Church. It's one of her favorite subjects. So kind of trying to cover her up and saying, it's not that bad. It's really not, it's not a big deal. She's a comedian on a daytime talk show. That should kind of lighten the message anyway.
You know why people are upset, though? Because they know she's right.
And actually, it kind of goes back to, I remember doing a story on the show. This was maybe 5 years ago. Who knows?
Showing off, huh?
Well, gotta do it when I can. When I get the chance, I gotta put it in there. But anyway, it was in one of these churches in somewhere in the East. Can't remember. But there was this famous prophet lady or something who would always have these mystical visions, stuff like that, and people would come to her advice. And they found out that where this church, I mean, it was a real church, actually existed. She actually existed and everything. And they found out that they did, studies on it. And the gas in the rocks and stuff like that below that if you spend a lot of time in there, you're going to whack up your mind. And so it's possible that, you know, I mean, if she was constantly living in this church, she was always exposed to these, you know, noxious gases coming from the rocks and whatever. She was just a little bit nutty. So
it reminds me, you know, I remember scenes, and this scene's been played a few times, so it's nothing original, but you'll have somebody who, is seeing something like a ghost or whatever, and somebody else will reach out and take off their glasses and wipe it and put it back on. And, oh, wow, where'd it go? I can see clearly now.
Yeah. Yep. Thus the drugs. Bayer's co-host, Elizabeth Hasselbeck, blasted Bayer's theory, noting that the late Mother Teresa, who has not yet been given sainthood, is a modern example of a saint. Bayer mentioned the recently revealed letters that suggest Mother Teresa struggled with doubts about her faith and contended that the Catholic Church's standards for sainthood have changed due to medical advances. That's why Mother Teresa had issues. Let's not forget she didn't really believe 100% like those saints who were hearing voices. She didn't hear voices. So.
Yeah, and, you know, I realize that, you know, the Catholics get to make up their own rules about who they get to make a saint. Yeah. But, you know, in any real sense, I think in order to for somebody to qualify for sainthood, and I realize, yes, this is an atheist saying it, I'd like to think that they'd have to be, good people. And not some evil harpy who encourages suffering around the world as, you know, God really wants you to feel the pain thoroughly so you appreciate your life. Don't come to me with Mother Teresa was a saint because I'm not buying it.
Yeah.
And now, of course, they've kind of built up this out now because of the letters where she expresses that she may not have actually believed for most of this time.
Yeah. Yeah.
So evidently all those evil things that she did with regard to suffering were her atheist side spilling over, because we're just really bad.
But of course, other people have to still back up Mother Teresa because of this, and saying, clearly she is no church historian. Saying she didn't believe 100% is a simplistic and superficial reading of the news. Why would you spend 60 years in a slum in the name of Jesus out of love for God if you don't believe in Jesus or God 100%? Well, the problem there is, what if she didn't do it for the love of Jesus and for the good of God for 60 years? What if she were doing it because she thought she was doing a good job to actually help people? That's a possibility. Even if she didn't believe, she could have been doing it because she thought she was doing a really good job. And the argument could be made that she did. So.
And the argument could be made that she didn't.
True.
I happen to think that she didn't, and I don't think, here's the thing, and it doesn't matter whether she believed in a God, actually, or believed that God was telling her to do things, or that she was doing stuff for God. She, as Daniel Dennett has put it, would have been somebody who believed in belief, that and not just strictly accepting Catholic dogma. I don't want to oversimplify it, but believed that both Catholic dogma and these broader principles of a God and helping people were good things. So in some level, I would agree that she probably felt that she was doing good things. The problem is that her definition of good and helping differed drastically from mine. Because if you've bought into this idea that suffering is a good thing, that we should, because it makes you feel more alive or teaches you more about life or makes you appreciate the moments when you're not suffering. That, to me, is a rationalization whose only real purpose can be the promotion of more suffering. Yeah. As a matter of fact, if that's your mentality, then what you'd really want is almost constant suffering, because the more you suffer, and the smaller the gaps are where you're not suffering,
the more you appreciate those gaps.
The more precious those gaps are.
Yeah.
I mean, it just has to be that way. Now, I differ from her in that I'd like to see us do everything we can to eliminate suffering entirely. Let's broaden those gaps of periods without suffering. And then maybe, when we do have to suffer a little bit, instead of appreciating how much better the non-suffering time is, we'll be able to go, ooh, we're pretty sure this will be over soon.
Yeah, I've never been a big fan of the whole suffering for for its own sake, or you learn better, you appreciate something if you had to work hard for it type mentality. I can understand the concept and the rationalization of it.
I have no problem with that.
But I still view it, this is kind of going back to, again, a while back I was reading over, I can't remember the guy's name now, but he did the different books with Jesus. Good Lord, I can't remember the name of it now.
Robin Price.
No. The Case for Christ.
Oh, Lee Strobel.
Yeah. The Case for Christ. And basically saying that we are suffering and there is pain and suffering on this earth because then we can learn better from it. And there are certain lessons that we learn better through suffering. And I disagree with that in the sense that a parent will have their children suffer in a certain way because there's no other way to do things. As in, you will make your, you know, newborn infant suffer through vaccination shots where doctors have to take them away and stick needles into them so that they don't have a greater suffering later on from polio.
Sure. I mean, that's kind of a practical...
Exactly. And so if there were a better way to do it where the child didn't have to be taken away and didn't have to cry, that would be preferable.
Yeah.
God, being almighty and all-knowing, can figure out a way that we can learn everything without having to suffer. We do it because it's necessary. There's no other practical way of doing this. There's no real practical way to learn history without just plain reading and studying.
Yeah.
So you've got to go through that. But God could just plant the knowledge in. Absolutely no suffering, no time taken, and you learn it.
Yeah,
you don't.
Or as you know, this omnipotent creator control of the universe could just frickin' eliminate suffering entirely.
Exactly. Exactly. And if you're an all loving, all powerful being, that should be the goal. That should be the goal.
And if you can't, then clearly there's some set of rules that's greater than God. Well, I'd really like to eliminate suffering, but you know, there's this rule book that says I can't.
Hey, the Daily Show's coming back on. God's got to watch it. So,
speaking of you know, eliminating saints with Thorazine, I'm one of the books that I'm going through now is a collection of the old dial-in atheist stuff.
Okay.
Evidently, groups from American atheists around locally, back before there was this, you know, internet and text messaging and YouTube. When people would actually like pick up a phone and dial a number just to hear a joke.
Yeah.
Which kind of baffles me. there was also Dial an Atheist. And okay. What they did was they collected a bunch of the different messages over the years. And Frank Zindler in Ohio was the one who did this when he put this book together. There's some great stuff in there. I'm going to have to email him about getting the rights to read some bits of it. But there's a song in there, which is a rewrite of Jesus Loves the Little Children. And, you know, it starts off normally, you know, Jesus loves the little children. But it's Jesus loves the little zygotes. And then it goes from there to talking about how Jesus likes to punish the little children with measles and mumps and chicken pox. And it's done subtly so that, yeah. I mean, I ratted reading it a couple times to really catch all that they were saying. But it's beautiful in that it ends with, but he cannot give them smallpox anymore. And that's, I mean, you know, I realize that technically we haven't completely eradicated,
yeah, but
because there's some nut jobs out there who are saying don't vaccinate your kids.
Yes.
So we, you know, but
and
in general.
More and more of those people are coming out of the woodwork, too.
In general, though, I'm vaccinated against smallpox, so all of you out there who'd like for God to demonstrate his power could simply pray for him to hit me with smallpox. That'd be pretty good. I mean, a disease that we've pretty much eradicated that I'm supposed to be immune to now. If God could hit me with smallpox, I think that'd be, I mean, it wouldn't be proof, but it'd be a start.
It'd be a step in the right direction.
Yeah. I don't think your God can give me as much as a hangnail, so.
Yeah, so go ahead, God, hit him.
Yeah, smite me.
Prove to me by giving him smallpox.
Hey, I should have thought of that.
All right, another one. This one's just...
Oh, we could make him regrow your hair. I mean, like...
I'm not too sure if that's like to be a joke or not.
Full on fro just overnight.
A big afro. I wake up tomorrow morning with a big afro.
God. He can do it. Doesn't he? He's got to have a sense of humor. I've seen the platypus.
All right. Okay. Another story here. And again, phone lines are open. If you've got any questions, comments.
Oh, which reminds me, somebody called a minute ago wanting us to cover what was going on at the Unitarian Universalist Church again. I don't have all the details with me, but I think that it begins at 7 o'clock tonight. There is a minister who's a former creationist who's now an evangelist for evolution who's giving some speech there. It's at the UU Church on Grover, which is between Lamar, Burnett, 45th, and 49th, I think. But okay. That's all the info I have on it.
Sure, a quick Google search on Unitarian Universalist Austin would probably bring it up.
Actually, you can look up. It was in yesterday's Statesman.
Okay.
So there's an article about it in the Statesman from yesterday. So.
Okay. All right, and here's a quick story that came up January 9th. That's just kind of one of these strange, funny things. This was in Ohio. A man who believed he bore the mark of the beast used a circular saw to cut off one hand. And then, as if that weren't enough to prove to God that he really did love and trust and he's a devoted follower, he microwaved it. Apparently, that's what's really needed to really get the demons out.
And I heard that he would have cut off the other one, but then he didn't have anything to grip the saw with.
The man in his mid-20s was calm when county sheriff's deputies arrived Saturday in his North Idaho town. He was in protective custody and mental health units. It had been somewhat cooked by the time your deputy arrived. He put a tourniquet on his arm before so he didn't bleed to death. That kind of mental illness is just sad.
Now, see, what was this reported?
And it also kind of funny points out hospital spokesman Lisa.
This is
something.
The Associated Press.
Yeah. Yeah.
How dare you email me about how I'm attacking religion? This guy just took somebody whose beliefs were obviously way more sincere than any of you guys.
Yeah.
And basically said he was nuts. Oh, this must be mental illness. He cut off his hand. It must be mental illness. She drowned her baby.
Which goes right back to the previous story. When do you say, at what point do you say God actually speaks to you? You know, if God says to do good things, then it's God speaking to you. You should listen to that. That's a cherished gift that you have, this personal relationship with God. But as soon as you thought God says cut off your hand or kill your kids or, you know, quit your job, then it's like, dude, you're just nuts.
Yeah, as long as God's telling you things that I agree with.
Exactly, then it's okay.
Yeah, then you're a real Christian. As soon as he starts telling you stuff that sounds crazy to me, well, oh, you're crazy.
You're nuts.
I'm glad we have such established and reliable criteria for determining who's nuts and who's not.
Exactly. And again, after he had cut off his own hand with a circular saw, put it in the microwave to partially cook it.
Was he going
to
eat it?
They don't say. But again, it's funny that the hospital spokesman would not say whether an attempt was made to reattach the hand.
And to the doctor, I'd just like to say, well done.
Permanent handy snack. Just gnaw off your fingers. All right, and that's mostly all that I've got. I think you said you might have one or two things. We can hit these other stories if there's really a need for them, but they're not all that critical. Again, phone numbers on your screen. If you've got anything, questions, comments, we'd definitely love to hear from you. As Matt was saying, it's good to hear what people think and why they believe and why you think other people should believe. It's good to hear. It's a good discussion.
So I guess we could just probably end the show right here and not say anything for the next, 45 minutes or so. Let's just do that.
We're waiting for your calls.
No, actually, there's something I wanted to hit on a couple weeks ago that we didn't, and this is an email, and it's long, and I've underlined sections to read, so I won't read the whole thing, but there's some things to comment on, and it goes towards what you were talking about a little bit as well. This guy goes by the name of Christian Peace, and he spammed this to a lot of people, I found out, but it's this kind of manifesto in all caps called The Three Faces of Satan.
But it's peaceful.
Well, yeah. This is a message from God. to all who hate God and refuse to believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. It is for all the devil worshippers and atheists and such that have decided to live a life without God as their Savior. You will serve the kingdom of God, you just don't know it. I am Christian Peace, the afflicted priest of Christ Jesus. You will scream and beg for mercy and find none.
Peace and love, brother. Peace and love.
Isn't that great? Jesus loves me. Without the Lord to protect you from the evil one, you will be terrified and there will be nothing you can do about it but suffer terribly. You will not escape the terror that grips your heart at the sight of the evil one, Satan. And that one, that phrasing, you know, not to be the English major guy, but are you calling me Satan or is Satan the evil one?
I'm sure we could spend a lot of time critiquing the English in here.
I have seen the true face of Satan. He's not human, but a beast, an ugly, terrifying-looking beast. Satan is truly ugly. There is no ugly human being when compared to that ugly beast. He's the definition of the word ugly. For him was the phrase uttered, ugly as sin. So Satan was
somewhat
kind of
repetitive.
Beaten with the ugly stick or something? Is that what you're saying? Not quite sure I got it. He goes on to describe it. He does have the features of a human form, with two eyes, a nose, and a mouth. But evidently,
they're ugly.
But if you ever look into that face, you will see that it is the face of a beast, a hideous beast. I'm skipping because it's like 18 million pages long. He actually talks about, when you see the buzzards of the Lord fill the sky by the thousands upon thousands, you will know that your day has arrived. It is your day of terror and all because you believed a lie. Satan lied to you and you believed his lies. Satan is a liar and the father of it. Think it over carefully. Think what over? So you're saying that I bought into something. I used to buy into something and now I don't buy into it anymore. It's not like I've bought into something new. It's not like I traded in one dogma for another. I simply reject the old dogma and the old claims that I don't, I don't believe anymore. I suppose you could say that Satan may be convincing me of a lie that God doesn't exist. And while I believe that the best explanation is that, actually these God things don't exist, I'm open to evidence. I'm just not open to Satan is really ugly, he's a liar, think about it. Okay, I thought about it.
Yeah, I thought about it for quite a while and decided.
Sure. Hey, somebody could have just emailed me and said, Jesus is a liar. Think about it. What? That's not an argument. It's not evidence. And mostly he's writing to devil worshippers here, but he's also an atheist. He wants to lump us together, but not completely. If you're an atheist and refuse to believe in God, you will believe on that day, but it won't do you any good. That's people have asked me that question before. Well, what are you going to do when you die and you find out that all this was true and you got to answer to God?
Then I'm going to believe.
Well, I'll believe at that point. Well, I don't see what the problem is. I mean, my parents or my mom asked me just the other day, the kind of thing of, what would you believe or why don't you believe? And my thing was, even if I did believe, if the God that this guy describes exists, if the God that's described in the Bible exists, I still wouldn't worship him.
Yeah,
that's an evil monster that's got one of the most insane and unjust systems ever. Oh, wait, you're born guilty because something your ancestors did, and this tainted the whole world so that you couldn't possibly be justified even if you wanted to, so... by the way, there's nothing you can do about it except turn off your brain and accept some faith-based claim, and I'll go ahead and pay your fine for you. I'm going to punish you for somebody else's crimes, but I'll pay your fine for you. What?
Which is always kind of why it's a ridiculous argument that we often get that God cannot, God does not want to prove his existence unequivocally.
Yeah,
because that would take away the need for faith, and that is what's so important. If everybody just automatically knew and trusted that, of course there's a God, then all of us would just, be forced, essentially, in some strange way, to love and worship him.
And that's not what he wants. He wants us to find him and form a relationship with him and stuff like that. And that can't be forced upon you.
Hey, here's a thought.
But then it goes back to what you just said of, even if, you know, God came down right now during the show, stomped around and said, I am real. What you read in the Bible is absolutely real. That's the last person in the world that I would worship.
You in a relationship with me and you're omniscient and omnipresent, well, I shouldn't have to look for you. If you've got special rules that you want me to live by and I'm going to be judged by these rules, tell me.
Exactly.
Don't give me some old book, you know, that in dead languages by people that I've never met can possibly verify, that contradicts itself, that contradicts science, that, well, frankly, as I look at it, it seems to be kind of unjust and immoral across the board. I mean, you know, that's like a parent who leaves a note on the refrigerator in somebody else's handwriting saying, do your homework, I'm going to kick your ass and throw you in the basement where your dad's going to beat you. What? I mean, you know, this God guy, he's got, you know, I created everything, including hell. So,
and you are condemned to it unless you do all of these special things and jump through the hoops to become my friend.
Yeah, and of course, he also has this doctrine that the worst thing you can ever do is disbelieve.
Yeah.
Whoops. Hey, you murdered a bunch of people. That's okay because he orders murders.
Yeah, you killed thousands of people. Probably shouldn't have done that, but I'll let you pass this time.
I'll cover you. Yeah. No problem. I got your back. meanwhile, you know, he's ordering Moses and these guys to go out and slaughter people wholesale. And, oh, by the way, if you come across anybody who's pregnant, be sure you slice them open so that there's no future versions of that clan that I hate so much.
Yeah.
But anyway, back to the wonderful message piece from today is your day of salvation. Tomorrow you will scream and beg for mercy and find none. I didn't say it. God said it. And I believe it. Well, how many times have you heard that?
I know.
The Bible says that a fool said in his heart there is no God. I didn't say it. I'm not calling you a fool, but God does.
But God does.
Don't you agree with him?
I'm just going to bring it to light, though. I'm not saying that. I'm just bringing it to light.
Don't you agree with him?
Well, no. Well, I mean, I don't know.
Don't you kind of have to agree with him? Isn't that the point? I'm not convinced that your God did say it or any God said it. Mm. You know, you haven't demonstrated that at all. So when you stand before God, you will drop to your knees and beg for mercy. I might. I mean, you know, fact this guy exists, and the people have asked, well, what would you say? And I always reply with things similar to what Ingersoll and others have said, which is, you know, I'll say, hey, I was honest in my thinking. You didn't provide sufficient evidence. You didn't answer any appeals that I made. What choice did I have but to disbelieve? Would you have rather that I just accepted something that I found to be immoral and unjustified, just on the off chance that it might be true in order to avoid punishment? Why, that seems kind of silly.
Would you rather I not use this wonderful brain that you have given me?
Yeah, the methodology that you've allowed us to determine everything else. I mean, this is absurd. So really, I mean, what we're talking about is a guy who essentially would have a gun to my head. Well, somebody walks in the studio and puts a gun to my head and says, I'm going to shoot you in the head unless you accept Jesus as your... Okay. I love you, Jesus.
Absolutely.
It doesn't mean I mean it or I believe that anything's in particular true, but, you know, if you're going to try and operate the universe by thuggery, I don't know how you're any different from a loan shark.
Yeah.
But, you know, break my kneecaps if I don't tell you how much... You know, and I've asked people, parents, specifically parents, about this before. About, you know, you've got kids. Would you ever reward one of them for doing something that was evil just because they looked at you and said they loved you? Mm. Would you ever punish one of them more than another? Well, punish one and reward one when the one you're punishing is for not accepting what you say verbatim? Would you, you know, build a torture chamber in your basement and say, I don't want you to have to go down there and be tortured. You got to tell mommy you love her. If you don't, it's down to the Iron Maiden for you. and by the way, would you ever punish any of your kids forever? For one thing they did.
For anything that they've done. Even if they could it be rotten. Worth eternal torment?
Yeah. And without fail, those who bother to answer the question, because most of them stop talking at that point, oh, no, I wouldn't do that. Well, congratulations. You are more moral than the God you believe in.
Yeah.
And so am I. So let's ditch that bozo and get about the business of actually dealing with reality.
Yeah. I was like Martin's analogy, I guess, of saying that. It's sort of like a husband saying to his wife, you know, honey, I love you, I respect you, I want you to stay, but if you ever leave me, so help me God, I will kill you.
Yeah.
Great guy.
So, evidently there'll be no mercy for anyone who denies the Son of God. Satan hates you, and you will know how much he hates you when you hear him growl in that darkness. Well, that's something that always confused me. I mean, really, how can it be dark if there's fire? But
we're just trying to get the practicalities down here.
There's other things about this that confuse me too, and that's this idea that Satan hates me. I mean, really, you've set up the system where Satan hates God, or maybe they're in cahoots. Because I mean, after all, God did create Satan knowing that he'd go bad, and he created us knowing we'd go bad. I mean, assuming you accept like this omniscience with the ability to see the future, and of course, if you reject that and God can't see the future, then please explain prophecy. All right. But so you've got, I don't understand, is he God's handyman? You know, I mean, in the Old Testament, he's God's accuser.
Okay.
And then, of course, there's this like gambling thing over Job. Yeah. I bet I can make him not believe you if you just let me screw up his life just enough.
Yeah.
So, oh yeah, do what you want. Go ahead. He'll still love me. Watch. He'll love me.
Yeah. That's a real nice God.
Yeah. I bet I can make your dog bite you if I kick him enough. Hey, yeah, go ahead, kick my dog. I don't really like him anyway. But he'll just come back over. I love you, master. Kick me again. Are you kidding? But, you know, really, I mean, if heaven is this place where people worship forever and hell is this place where all the sinners are tortured forever, and it seems to me that we've kind of established like a battle of the soul collectors.
Yeah.
So that God's trying to get as many as he can, only he doesn't seem to be making any effort at all to demonstrate that this is what he wants to do. And that Satan's trying to get all he can, but he hates us and wants to torture us. It seems like the best thing that Satan could do if he wants to topple God, and I'm assuming that he's reasonably intelligent, is to, I don't know, step up on earth and say, hey, everybody, I'm Satan. Not nearly as bad as these guys have made me out to be, and I'm not going to torture you at all. Actually, all I need you to do is just side with me in this little battle thing. We'll hook you up downstairs. You can have your own. There's no fire and brimstone and all this stuff. We've got, you know,
there's
beer and
there's
hookers.
There's a big central fireplace.
Yeah, you know.
You know, we have barbecues.
It's
there
a nice
on the
one where you can see through from room to room.
Yeah, it's been vastly overblown.
Yeah, so. And you know, there's good food down there. And when you get there, you don't have to sit around and, you know, worship people and play harps and do all
the
this.
Harp music gets real old, trust me.
I mean, you know, wouldn't that be the quickest way? Oh yeah, everybody's going to be, you know, well-fed, pleasant, and have a good time. I mean, if your real goal is to win souls and people are as base and immoral as God seems to think they are, that'd certainly be the quickest way.
And as most believers seem to think they are.
Yeah.
They all assume that we are just rotten to the core.
Well, I was told, you know, just a few days ago that we're all sinners, including those Christians. They're not perfect.
As bad.
They're just forgiven.
Yeah.
But that, in fact, I never made any real effort to consider this God question. I just fell in love with sin and wanted to get rid of God so that I wouldn't feel guilty.
Yeah, heard that one more than once.
Yeah, not quite what happened, but we don't need to go into that. We got, is it Stan?
Yes.
Hey, how you doing?
Hey.
I'm doing well.
Oh, it's you, Stan.
Yes, hi.
Hey, how was your holidays?
Oh, I don't do the holidays.
At all? You don't celebrate the birth of Frosty?
Not at all.
That's a shame.
I look at that as celebrating Satan's return.
No. Well, maybe as somebody who believes Satan's return?
Yes.
What's Satan going to do when he returns?
Oh, well, he's got a little time left. He's going to try and do what he can to mess things up, but basically he's going to be crushed.
Okay. And how you know he's going to be crushed?
Well, I'm going off the Bible.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what did you call in and talk about?
Well, I heard you guys talking about hell and all that, and it's kind of sad because the Father in heaven has no plans to put his children in a fiery place and burn them up.
Didn't you just say that you got this whole thing about Satan returning from the Bible?
Yes.
So I take it you just dismissed those other passages in the Bible where he talks about the hell that he has prepared for the Satan and his followers?
Well, hell is a place where people, well, not necessarily people, but certain ones are going to be put and destroyed
rather quickly. Certain ones?
Huh?
What certain ones?
Well, it looks like it's preserved for... how can I put this without sounding too totally nuts? Satan's seed, perhaps. And in the parable of the tares, it talks about the end of the world and the gathering up of the wheat. And
so I'm not going to hell?
No.
But I've committed apostasy. That's the one unforgivable crime. I can't go to heaven, so do I just cease to exist then?
Oh, you got a good chance like everybody else, and it looks like...
I got a good chance. What passage in the Bible are you basing that on?
Well, I don't take just any one passage and try and make a big thing out of it.
You kind of weave a story from bits and pieces of different passages?
Yeah, that it looks to me like everyone that doesn't have the Holy Spirit, ones in the first century, they got the Holy Spirit, they went to heaven. Another group later on down the road, they're going to go to heaven, great multitude, and then everyone else is going to be raised to a new physical life and be given not a first chance, but a first chance to have a chance to live the right way when Jesus is here on this planet. So everybody gets a good chance.
I don't remember that verse, but I understand that you have kind of a different perspective on it. You're not following any particular religion, and
right.
You kind of do your own thing, but yeah.
Uh-huh. And that's the way it looks to me. There are parts of the Bible which talk about a place where certain beings are going to be put. It gets back to that whole thing David Icke was talking about, and all kind of interesting. He labels them a reptilian race. And in a way, one might put some small amount into that of the idea that there is this perhaps other seed on this planet.
Sure. So I'm not being overly critical. You're saying that David Icke's conspiracy theories are in some sense correct, but instead of calling them reptiles, you'd call them demons or Satan's seed type things?
Not Satan, demons, but another race. Is getting to the parable of the tares, which Jesus spoke about, the two groups that grew together on the earth and in the end time would be harvest.
Right.
They were left together until the end time. Certain ones were to be burnt.
So you do agree with this kind of general view of some kind of global elite conspiracy that's being run by some non-human entity.
Yeah.
Okay.
And that's why there's been things on the planet that God did, like with Noah, when...
I was wanting to ask you, too, since you have kind of your own take on these things, do you think that was a local flood or a global flood?
Well, it looks to me like evidence of... geographic evidence that it was a local thing, generally speaking, in a local area. So it looks like some reason, not all of the seed was destroyed at that time, but it was...
Oddly, though, in the Bible it says that God's purpose and intent was to destroy everything that walks the earth.
Those translations are a little hard. Hebrew is kind of hard to
be
sure with any accuracy, but it does look that way in most translations.
I think you could probably ask a Jew.
Yeah. But it seems like that whole thing pictured a time on Earth when certainly needed to put a little damper on things, as it were.
So you would look at it, I guess, as written by men and not completely accurate and perhaps metaphoric, or maybe got some elements of it wrong, or phrasing is changed and now we don't have as good understanding of what the true meaning was as we did in the past?
Well, we certainly can't for sure know everything like they would have then, and there are some problems with translations we have and other concerns. So, but generally speaking, the story seems to be that was for a reason, the reason being that this other seed was being put on Earth, and so that is what God had to intervene there to keep that from happening in such a big way.
Why did that other seed start propagating in the first place?
Well, I don't know exactly. There seems to be a battle in the world, in the spiritual world, for control over this planet. For some reason, God's allowed this planet to go on for the last 6,000 years or so, and it looks like it's...
What about the 4.5 billion years before the last 6,000?
Well, I think the world was prepared for mankind, and then made, it was in some sort of chaos.
So God's got this really slow build-up with a huge
for humans
finish.
To be able to inhabit the world about 6,000 years ago, since the written history of man.
Okay. I don't know, did you have any questions for Stan?
No, I don't.
I don't have any other callers, Stan. We can talk about Bible stuff all day if you want.
Well, you're certainly welcome to hit me with any questions you have. I know you were...
Well, the thing is
hell is kind of sad because people back then used to torture people to get them to leave their way. And so that's kind of a man-made thing put in there. A lot of the parts that talk about torture are just...
Well, that's the thing that kind of baffles me, is that, you know, you feel free to go through the Bible and say, oh, these bits are man-made and this bit's not accurate, but there really is a Satan, there really is this I don't know, broad conspiracy to control souls or whatever on the planet, and always coming back, and there is this end-time stuff. But don't worry, even though you're an apostate who's openly made fun of God and considers the paradigm immoral... you've got just as good a shot as getting heaven. What kind of system? That seems even less fair to me than anything.
I'm sorry, didn't catch the last part.
That system even seems even less fair than the one I'm objecting to. I mean, at least in the Orthodox version, you have to do something. What's the point in buying into the story that you've accepted or generated, actually, and living a particular life, if me sitting here as somebody who rejects all of that has, you know, just as good a shot of getting to heaven as anybody else? And why would I want to go?
Well, I know heaven is pictured as very often a place that is...
there's no description, so, I mean, invent it.
It has physical area, time, it has looks like a city and trees and...
Sure, we know there's mansions, pearly gates, streets of gold, but really there's no description of it.
Yeah, there's a very good description. There seems
Where?
To be time, and there seems to be at least one river, and there also is the tree of life there.
Now, if you're going to go into the descriptions that are there, then also there's the cliff edge where the people up in heaven can peer over into hell to watch people being tormented.
Well, no, that's in one part with Lazarus. That was definitely a parable, and so parables are just stories, but they picture a certain thing.
You're talking about Luke chapter 16.
And you can't use that one parable to say that there's a hell, although that people do. But that picture of Lazarus, if you look, it was said for the Pharisees, and so So it seemed to be a warning for those particular men of the that they could end
actually,
up in
that's
a,
not what I was referring to, but that's okay. I mean, you're talking about in Luke 16 where he's talking about Lazarus and Dives.
Yeah.
Yeah. And Dives isn't even really a name. It just means rich man.
Right. And so that was a parable. But people use that to describe
hell. But isn't
hell.
The purpose of a parable to teach us a little bit more about the real paradigm that exists?
Well, to a certain degree, but you can't use that to... you have to look at the preponderance of the rest of the places in the Bible where it talks about hell being the grave, destruction.
I did this big, long lecture a few months ago. You can actually go online to the website and download the lecture that I did on the history of hell, not only from a biblical perspective, but within other religions and within books that didn't make it into the modern Bible, like The Apocalypse of Peter, which is my personal favorite, which was considered inspired scripture by everybody early on. It's in the Moratorium Fragment, and it's a really detailed description of heaven and hell. And the only reason that it's not in the Bible today is because people didn't like to read from it from the pulpit. They didn't like to read about people who were, you know, being burned in a lake of fire while their aborted babies poked them with sticks and flew around their head.
Yeah.
They didn't like to hear about homosexuals jumping off of a cliff onto all of the other homosexuals who then had to climb back up the hill and jump onto them again and do this over and over for eternity. Yeah. But it was still considered inspired scripture by all the early church fathers and was included in the first New Testament canons.
Early church fathers, are you talking about Catholics?
The early church fathers like Eusebius and Irenaeus,
yeah,
and all of those who built the Bible that you're referring to, yeah, and picking and choosing from?
I still don't put a whole lot of credence into a
obviously,
lot of their
since
writings,
you pick and choose so. Which parts you like and don't.
Huh?
I mean, that I understand, but I'm saying that you don't seem to have any criteria with which to support the picking and choosing that you're doing.
Well, the criteria I have is... the Bible itself, let's stick to what we have in the, not some of the Gnostic stuff that comes out later.
I understand. I will recant any comment that came from text. By the way, Apocalypse of Peter isn't Gnostic. But my thing is that you don't seem to have a criteria to be able to determine which parts you're going to accept out of the Bible and which parts you're going to reject. And when I just asked you about that, you say that you're using the Bible itself.
Well, I certainly am, and the parts, it's not like I just pick and choose from parts.
It is like that, actually.
Well, I disagree. I'm okay. Going from the basically the authorized version of the Bible, let's say, and some things, though, that came later, some of the writings that came later are a little iffy, and so I can't make a whole opinion and disregard the rest of the preponderance of evidence because of that. But from the preponderance of evidence in the New Testament and the rest of the Old Testament, I can safely come to the conclusion that God has no plans to burn his children for eons.
Now that depends on how you define his children, because within a biblical context, his children only qualifies as those people who are saved, not those who are going to be burned.
Well, the ones that do end up in a place where it's talked about as being a fire, lake of fire, are going to be destroyed right away. So it looks like there's going to be certain beings that are destroyed right away. A lot of this comes from the fact that people and have borrowed ideas from the Greeks that we have some sort of immortal soul. So then
So we don't have an immortal soul. Is that we don't have an immortal soul?
No, and the Bible is not saying that. People have put that into the Bible. A soul is just a living being. So
okay. So are there people in heaven now?
Yeah.
And yet their bodies and everything are decomposing underground. So what's in heaven?
Well, they're spiritual beings.
Oh,
isn't
that the soul thing that you just said we don't have?
No, a soul, as in the Bible, is a living being. If you look in start out in the beginning to the end and you look at every place where it says soul, it's always referring to a living being. Fishes were souls. Some animals were souls. So a soul is just a living being which can die. And
okay,
so,
but so that's not what we meant when we said soul earlier. So there is an eternal spiritual being.
There are spirit beings and there are living, breathing, fleshly beings. So.
Okay. And yet...
Is it kind of like a symbiotic relationship type thing where they inhabit the same space on Earth and then when
the flesh being dies and the spiritual being continues?
The saints of the first century were taken to heaven.
So, I mean, is there a spiritual being in me right now?
No, that's like you're saying, is trying to get back to the whole idea of a mortal soul. There's
okay.
No spiritual being.
So if I'm entirely a physical being...
I'm sorry?
I'm a physical being.
Yes.
And there's no spiritual being here.
Right.
Okay. Then if only spiritual beings go to heaven, then I can't go to heaven.
Not right now.
Ever.
No. You could be changed.
No. Stop.
Yeah.
I'm a physical being.
Right.
There is no spiritual being here.
And no, it's there is only no spiritual being here. But you could be changed into a spiritual being, like Paul talked about changing a twinkling of an eye.
Changed into a spiritual being?
Yes.
When does that happen?
Well, for those men in the first century, it happened when Jesus returned for them, probably around the year 70, when the temple was destroyed. And so those men were changed, just like Paul said, from physical beings to spiritual beings.
But how is that me? That's what I'm asking.
Well,
hang on, let me finish.
They had the Holy Spirit.
Stan, hang on. We're going to give you all kinds of time.
Yeah.
I just want to... How is that me? Because to me, as a physical being,
uh-huh.
everything that makes up what I am is physical and is a component, particularly, of my brain. So am I, like, downloaded into a spiritual body? Are my thoughts and consciousness downloaded into a spiritual body? Because if later I'm just turned into a spiritual being, how is that still me? Because there's nothing, there's no bridge between the two of them. They're separate entities. So I'm just curious as to how I become this spiritual being.
Well, I'm not privy to all the details there.
Then why would
you
think
that
exactly that it
happens? All I know is that's what happened to the saints in the first century who had the Holy Spirit.
How do you know that's what happened?
Well, I'm going by the biblical record.
The biblical record that you pick and choose from?
Well, that I study very hard to try and understand.
Okay.
So,
what makes you think you've got it right?
Well, I can't say I got everything right.
What makes you think you got any of it right?
Sometimes I'm wrong and sometimes I'm right, but I do the best I can there, and I sometimes change my views as I learn new things, so not everything's going to be set in stone. If I learned something different, I would change my views on it, but that's right now where I'm at with it, that certainly the things that happened to those men in the first century, when I read the Bible, I look at things being specifically for those people. So when Jesus said to go and preach to all nations, he meant to those guys, not to us. And when he told them that he'd return for them and people would still be alive when he returned, that he was speaking to, I believe that's what Jesus said, and that he came back and took those men. And so after everyone
so
left...
So you believe he's already come back once in addition... in order to fulfill what he said, that some of you standing here will still be alive or will not see death until these things come to pass.
He came back
around
70 AD.
So what you're saying is that around when?
70 AD when the temple was destroyed.
So in the time period between his death, which, first of all, we don't have any reason to think that any of this happened, but his death in 30-ish, 33 to 70, he fulfilled all those obligations. So the gospel was preached in all nations in that period of time?
The known world, yeah.
The known world.
Those people. Those
doesn't
men,
God know the whole world?
The world for those men was the...
So God's only concerned about saving the world as those men knew it and screw the rest of them?
Well, there was a kind of first fruits bunch, a pioneer group, if you have... there, not everyone in the whole world, of course, but just that general area of the known world that they were in at the time is how one would understand that. Those men were just generally speaking, locally through the Mediterranean area and spread out from Jerusalem outward. So it was the known world for them. So that statement, go and preach to all nations, all people, was applicable, and you can understand it to say that just those particular nations that were in that area at the time. So, and then after Jesus came for those people, there was no one left to have the Holy Spirit, and so everyone went to heaven with Jesus, and that's where they are. But there's going to be another group later on in the future that is a bigger group, so many can't be counted, called the Great Multitude, and they're going to have a similar experience where that group is going to be changed into spirit beings sometime in the future.
It's an interesting story. I just don't see how you can justify any of it or where what reason you have for thinking any of this is true in the first place.
I look in detail at what it says, and I kind of reject.
I understand that, Stan, but I could do the same thing with any book.
Yeah, the problem here kind of comes up as how do you know that what you're reading and your interpretation of it is the correct one, and it's not Satan, the devil, demons having a field day with you and your interpretations. Matt obviously has a very different interpretation of these kind of things than you do.
Well,
who's to say that he's not got the right one and Satan's been having a field day with you, or the other way around?
You do the best you can there, and it's good if it makes sense. It makes a lot more sense to me that God would give everyone a chance, for one, and I'd always...
So you go into it with a preconception about what you think the nature of God is, and you read that into whatever you're reading in order to make it say what you want it to say.
No, I look at
it. That's what you said. I just phrased it differently.
Objective and analyze it as best I can so that
to
I can make sense of it all.
Your preconception. My question is, ignoring interpretation entirely, you're making assumptions about the truth of what's in the book, that anything in the book actually happened. And I'm curious as to why you would think that anything in that book actually happened.
Well, I think that that gets down to the central question of whether you believe that book is, even with its problems of translations and other things that you have with it, is a historical record of what happened to those men. And so... I have,
and you believe it is.
That's so.
Okay. So what? Why? Makes,
from my perspective, I look at it. Okay, if these things happen, how was it for those men? And I also look at it as when I read it, I don't apply the things to myself today that were said to men 2,000 years ago.
So from your perspective, you judge the Bible to be historically accurate, because this is about the third or fourth time we've had this piece of discussion, and every time I ask you what reason you have for thinking it is, you can't provide no evidence. You just say, from your perspective, you believe that it's true.
Well, just like from your perspective, you don't believe it's true.
Yes, so, but my perspective, no. My perspective is based on the fact that there's insufficient evidence to justify the claim that it's true. You don't get to say that we have equally valid yet opposing viewpoints.
Well,
you're accepting something is true. And the only justification that should be used to accept something as true is evidence to support the claim.
Right.
Not a lack of evidence to prove it wrong. Not a personal viewpoint about your preconceptions of what may or may not be true about it.
Well, I have no reason to believe it is not true.
You're just not getting it, Stan. I just, not 10 seconds before, said that the burden of proof has nothing to do with evidence that proves it wrong. And we got actually full lines, and you've been on for a while, so I thank you for calling, but we're going to move on to some others now. I don't know how that gets missed. If you've got a claim...
I haven't seen anything to prove me wrong, so...
Yeah. I haven't seen anything that proved that there's not leprechauns, stealing socks out of my dryer. Doesn't mean that's what's happening. But anyway, we got Tim. How you doing? Hello?
Tim,
going once, twice.
We know you're there.
I can hear you breathing.
Hello.
Tim.
Ah, there you go.
Yes, am I on the television?
You are.
Yes, I would like to talk about things.
What would you like to talk about?
You called us.
Yes, I know, but you're on the TV, and I see we're talking about news today.
We had some news stories earlier.
I have some news for you.
Okay. Oh, seems that you got disconnected.
Man, you got to get off the coffee, Matt.
Yeah, you got to be quicker than that if you're going to actually, you know, try that. But is it John?
That's John. Yeah.
Hey, welcome to
the
show,
John. Am I on TV?
You're on TV.
Cool. How are you guys doing?
Good. How are you doing?
I'm doing okay. Hey, would you talk about some other faiths?
The what?
I mean, I haven't seen your show a whole bunch, but I flipped through the TV and I've seen y'all on a time or two. And mostly what I see is, well, doing today, or what I've seen in the last 30 minutes, the Christian.
Yeah, you know why?
Fasting. Huh?
You know why?
Because you live in a Christian society and it's what's around you, and so you comment on it?
Yeah.
Could you just take
calls.
A moment and talk about some others?
Yeah, and if we have tons of time. As a matter of fact, almost all the programs are available on Google Video. And we've done shows on nearly every religion I can think of. The show's mostly caller-driven, and I don't get a lot of Hindu callers. I'd be happy to discuss it with them. But one of the things is that I don't want to come on here too often and presume what other people believe. I'd rather have them, as I did with Stan, tell me what they believe, and we'll discuss whether or not I think there's any reason.
You presumed quite a bit about what Stan believed,
hmm?
It seemed like to me.
Well, Stan and I have had a lot of conversations on the show, so I already know what some of his answers are.
That may be true. But just do me a favor. Talk a bit on, I'll give you two. Scientology, Church of Scientology.
Actually, one of the very first programs I ever did was an entire show on Scientology and their wacky beliefs and how this is a money-sucking cult that is dangerous.
Awesome. Well, tell me some more about that. Could you just tell me about it?
Like what?
Well, I don't know much about it. I'm calling.
You can go down to the Scientology Center and you can get some of their information. But essentially, L. Ron Hubbard was a science fiction author and decided to basically invent a religion. You can go, as the website on the screen shows, there's information at clambake.org. The general principle is that there are spiritual beings called thetans glommed all over you, and they're the source of all misery and everything else, and your job is to sit there and clear yourself and become clear by removing these body thetans that are essentially poisoning your real being.
Okay, what's the extortion angle?
Oh, well, essentially you have to buy their products to learn more and more about the religion.
That's part of their doctrine, that's the one way to freedom from the... I'm sorry, did you say thetans?
Thetans, body thetans. It's not necessarily... I don't know that it's the one way to salvation, because actually, if you don't have enough money, you can, in fact, sign a contract for, I think it's 1 billion years is the minimum term... and actually work for them on either their Sea Org vessels or in one of the Scientology centers. And you, as part of your earnings, you can then purchase the higher level materials.
Well, at least they make accommodations. What about...
Yeah, the problem is that the accommodations really kind of segregate you from everybody else that's not a Scientologist. And in some cases, it's actually led to the death of members because they... And there's a big dispute about what actually happened. But
I'm sorry,
one of the
did you say real death of real people?
Yes.
That'd
you can find out more about
where
that at Clan Bake.
On that?
Sorry?
Where could I find information on that?
Well, the website that's on your screen right now is more information about that.
Okay. Well, thank you. I didn't mean to offend you guys. I was just asking some
questions. No, I'm not offended. The best thing I can suggest, though, is to go to atheist-experience.com. Click on Archives, and then expand the archives so that you can see all of them on the page. There's a listing of every show we've done and what the topics are. Most of them are available on Google Video, and there have been shows on Scientology, Muslims, Hinduism.
Judaism.
We've done
everything.
Judaism and some of the kind of how religions have adopted things from other religions.
Yeah. And we're glad to discuss this stuff if we have actually, you know, callers calling in, asking questions, you know, giving their... perspective and stuff like that. We'll gladly discuss it.
Well, good. Gladly discuss
it. But if everybody calls in and says, I want to discuss, you know, Jesus, 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 well, that's what we're going to talk about.
My
Okay, let's talk about Muhammad's claims as a prophet. Tell me why this is foolish.
About what?
Nation of Islam, Muhammad, the prophet. Right. Tell me about that.
Mostly, that's very much the same as Jesus. It's
what
a guy
do you,
who
what do you want to know? I mean, my interest here is in what the callers believe and what they want to discuss, and we can have a conversation about it. I don't just come on here to give Wikipedia snippets.
Well,
on
I've read
every
the Bible,
the
so when you tell me about the contradictions in it and the fairy tale nature of this or that or the other, I can follow all that. I haven't done that for the Quran, but
okay.
I'm assuming that you have.
I'm sorry. I was just, your call's really breaking up. What is it? What is the problem or the point?
That well, I'm asking. I was going to ask you to enlighten me on the your views of the Quran. I'm saying that I've read the Bible, so when you refer back to various things in it, I can follow.
Right.
But the Quran, which you haven't talked, which I've never heard you talk about, I don't know. So I was wondering, can you tell me something in there that is particularly foolish in your opinion? For example, correlated to the Bible discussion, God commanding the Israelites to wipe out a community for.
Sure, there's specific passages in there saying that infidels should not be allowed to live. The problem is that there's also passages in there saying that they are. There's similar. Actually, a really good site for information on that is skepticsannotatedbible.com because they also have a skeptics annotated Quran. It's not complete and exhaustive.
Skeptic annotated Bible?
Yes.
Is that a website too?
Skepticsannotatedbible.com is a good website that also has the skeptics annotated Quran. My point of this isn't just to pick out a religion and tell you everything that's wrong with it. The things that we end up discussing are what people believe and why, and whether or not a belief is justified. So, you know, and I don't pretend to be an expert in Islam or even Scientology, even though I did the one show on Scientology, or even Christianity, despite my experience there as well. It just happens to be the most common. My objection to Islam, for example, and there's plenty that are about kind of the ethics and the teachings of Islam. But my real objection is that nobody has presented me with sufficient evidence to believe that the claims of Islam are true. That's it.
Or any religion.
And that's true for any religion. That's the only issue. They are making a claim, and they are failing to meet their burden of proof to demonstrate that it's true. And until such time as one of them does, the default position is to reject all of them. We're out of time again this week. Thanks. We got like 30 seconds or so left. Thanks to John, Tim, and Stan for calling in. We still didn't get to all the rest of the crazy stuff in this diatribe from Christian Peace. We'll be back again next week. There's a listening to the crew. We appreciate everybody's help. And we'll see you next week. Join us at El Arroyo on 5th Street in just a few minutes.